Wherever you come to the gold-covered bridge that leads to Hell, you may find it guarded by a giantess. She will ask your name. She will ask your lineage. She will ask your business. The Northmen tell of the warrior woman Brynhild, who leapt into fire and rode to Hell to join her slain love Sigurd, and is challenged by the giantess.
The journey to Helheim is never a straight one. Each must find their own path. Align yourself to its secrets, and you will find yours.
Hela possesses large dwelling places in Helheim. Tall are her walls, high are her gates. The name of her dish is hunger. Her knife is famine. On her threshold, all stumble. Her bed is called sickbed, and her bed hangings are called flames of a funeral pyre. They say she is easy to recognize, half black and half the color of flesh. And her face, menacing and grim.
Of the darkness. It's coming. This is your moment.
sorry. I can't watch this.
What are you doing? You're showing weakness. You're not a warrior. You're a disgrace. The gods will punish you for this. Pick up the sword. Pick it up. Fight the darkness. Fight it. Get up. Get up. Get up and fight.
Stormy seas and lost souls. She's dreamt of this before. They say dreams are visions of our memories, thoughts, and fears, as seen by our inner eye. But what if each one of us is always dreaming, even when awake, and we only see what our inner eye creates for us? Is this what hell is? A world shaped by Senua's nightmares. Maybe that's why people feared seeing the world through her eyes. Because if you believe that Senua's reality is twisted, you must accept that yours might be too.
You failed the gods. You're pathetic. Rotten. Cursed. What were you thinking? Did you really think you could win? How stupid can you be?
So stupid.
Everyone hates her. She's cursed.
The shadow hates.
Look at you. A warrior. Worthless. Weak. Pathetic. Go on. Feel sorry for yourself, because there's no one left to do that for you. Take it. If you're too much of a coward to fight, then end the suffering. Broken and lost. Just like your sword.
Come on. There.
Why go on, when you give everything and face that which torments you, only to find that it is worse than you could have imagined? Why go on? Is it really so weak to ask this? Or are we just so afraid of the honest answer that we do not dare pose the question? Sometimes the answer lies in a memory, a feeling. Song.
It's not real. It's a trick. It's not real. It's real. Listen to it.
She can't give up.
Dillion. It's
not like this.
It's not real. It's real. It's a trick. Don't trust it. Maybe you're already dead.
Who are you?
Do you still believe in yourself?
Thank you.
Before she first met him, she was not in a good place. Just a teenager, but not like the others. Barely functioning, she rarely left the house. Her father, Zinbel, made sure of that. Only occasionally did she venture out on her own, collecting firewood and herbs. Errands out in the Orkney Plains. Was her world. Like this one. Barren and lonely. There he was, the lone figure of a boy, swordplay under the shade of a tree. She remembers the first time she saw him. To her young eyes, he moved as if dancing, and the world danced with him. The gloom lifted. For the first time in years, she felt a ray of hope.
The Northmen tell of a great hero. His name is Sigurd. His father's hall was built around a great tree, and one day, Odin comes and thrusts a sword into the tree, a gift to whomever can release it. Many try.
Thank you.
death for Sigmund and his brother seems certain. But the king's wife is Sigmund's sister, and she begs for mercy and implores the king to chain them up instead. He agreed. Not for mercy, though, but because he plans an even more cruel and lingering death. Chained to a tree in the forest that night, a she-wolf comes and devours one of Sigmund's brothers. She returns, ravenous, night after night, until only Sigmund is left. The next day, Sigmund's sister sends a servant with honey to smear on Sigmund's face. But to what end? Well, that night, when the she-wolf appears again, you'll never guess what happens.
Watching from afar, she mimicked him,
perfecting her own secret dance, wishing those fleeting moments of light would stretch out to last forever.
As the she-wolf licks the sweet honey from Sigmund's face, he bites the wolf's tongue. The she-wolf pulls away, but Sigmund holds on. The chains break, and he is free. After his escape, Sigmund lives like us, hidden in the forest. His enemy, King Sigir, believing him dead, as his sister.
He so effortlessly caught the world in bliss.
If only she could do the same. See the world through eyes anew. And dance with it. Just like he does.
What's your name?
Senua.
I haven't seen you before.
I'm not. I don't leave home much.
Oh. Zeno's daughter.
I have to go.
Wait. Who taught you to fight like that?
No one.
No one?
Well, I watched you, and...
You... learned all of that from watching me? You should become a warrior, you know.
Me?
I'm Dillion. I'm here for the warrior trials. Just come and watch. Bring your sword.
You can't put it into words. That moment when you look into the eyes of the one who is supposed to reassure you. Make you feel safe. takes an instant. Fear swallows you before you have a chance to make sense of it. And darkness becomes a part of who you are. But her world changed the day the Northmen took him from her. Senua knows that there's no going back to how things were. That there's nothing to go back to at all.
Stay still, stay quiet, hide, and don't tell her.
Their gods can see into your mind. They will use this power to destroy you.
They won't stop me. I can still feel him.
Whatever's left of him, they will never let him go.
I'm not gonna let him rot here!
You're the one rotting here.
Leave me alone.
You will die here.
No!
And all your suffering will have been for nothing!
Shut up!
Sigmund's sister trades shapes with a sorceress, and in disguise, she lies with her own brother. She gives birth to a son named Sinfjotli. After a time, she sends him to the forest to Sigmund. He tests the boy and finds him strong and fearless, and so they go to take their vengeance on King Siggeir. But luck is not on their side. They're captured, and Siggeir has them buried alive. As Sigmund and Sinfjotli are being buried alive, Sigmund's sister throws an armful of straw into the grave mound. Hidden in the straw is Sigmund's sword, the gift of Odin. They cut their way out of the grave mound and set fire to Siggeir's hall. The king burns to death. Sigmund calls to his sister to come out.
imagine a sword that can slay gods? Its name is Gramr. It was forged by the god of all Northmen, Odin, and gifted to Sigmund, a great warrior.
I need this sword. It's important. Can you help me?
The sword appears whole, but it is an illusion. It shattered into shards long ago. It is said a great warrior can reforge Gramr by answering the trials of Odin, one for each shard. The roots of the Tree of Death will take you to new lands where you will face the trials.
Go to the shards. Go to the shard.
Go to the shard.
What's the shard? Find it.
It's the metal runestones.
It's in front of you.
Find it.
The metal. The runes.
The king in the north forced the dwarves to make a sword that would never fail and never rust, and that would slice through iron and stone and bring victory to its bearer. But the angry dwarves cursed it. It would be the death of a man every time it was drawn, and it would be the death of the king. Let me tell you about the sword Tyrving.
I don't recognize this place.
Where are we? Where is she? It feels wrong. Where are we now? Burial mound. So strange that we go to such lengths to bury death. Something so very ordinary. Inevitable. It's as if we conspire to hide death. Because we have no answer for it. But when it comes and forces itself onto our friends or loved ones, then comes the reckoning. Dillion, I'm here. I'm here for the trials. Like when we first met, remember?
He's gone.
How did you let him go? What's wrong? What happened? Can you hear me? Just wait there. I'll find you.
Find him. Use everything you have and find him. Get him back.
He was just there. How could you lose him? How could she lose him?
How could she? Find him.
Him. calling to you. Can you hear him?
Where is he?
He sounds like he's getting further away.
Have you lost him?
You're going the wrong way.
Are you lost and have you lost him?
Where are you? Turn left.
Turn right.
Over this way.
What was that?
This way. Follow this way.
Nothing.
Where are we?
Senua, you remind me of a story that the Northmen tell about a young woman warrior. Her name is Herver, the daughter of a berserker, born after he was killed. She's a wild, willful child who teaches herself to fight with weapons. When she learns where her father is buried, her only desire is to reclaim the treasure buried with him, but above all, the sword, Tyrvin. Herver disguises herself as a man to join a band of warriors, and soon becomes their leader. When they come to the island where her father is buried, her men do not want to go ashore. They say that evil haunts the island, and that it is a worse place by day than other places are by night. Fearless, she lands alone. There are many grave mounds, and all of them have ghostly flames burning over them. She comes to the grave mound of her father after passing through these ghostly fires as though they were mist. The flames I passed through were real enough. Damn the Northmen to hell.
Find another way. It's not working.
You have to use your mind. Where can you go?
You're failing. Find another
think.
Way.
Think. Focus.
Where's he gone? He's disappeared. You need to slip through your fingers once again.
Think clearly. You have to find
another way.
There
has
to
be another way.
Don't recognize it.
Don't doubt yourself, you'll never find it.
She doesn't recognize it.
Yes, you do. You know where you are.
She doesn't.
Listen for his voice. Listen.
Dillion, where
listen
are you?
Listen for his voice.
Dillion.
She can't hear it. Does everything look the same?
Looks the same.
Something's different. Look for clues.
What is it?
What's different?
There's a clue.
Doesn't sound like Dillion.
What's happening? It's not him, it can't be.
What's that sound? The voice is changing.
What? That's not Dillion.
That doesn't sound.
Within the burial mound, Hervor calls on her father to wake from death and bring her his sword. She says that it is not seemly for the dead in their grave mounds to bear valuable weapons. Her father answers with words of warning. You go to your doom. Baleful runes surround you. You have gone mad. You have lost your mind. Your thoughts are confused. It is dangerous to wake the dead. Like I said, she reminds me of you.
Where are we?
She has no idea.
We're going round in circles.
You have fallen in.
You think that sound is Dillion's voice, is a trap?
You walked right into their hands.
They have you right where they want you.
How could you?
You think that voice is Dillion's?
It's not.
It's beckoning.
It's not Dillion. Dillion wants me to face my fears. Father? I'm leaving. I've decided. I think it will be good for me.
It's the darkness. It's speaking through.
No, Dad, it's me. I think I can beat it. In my own way.
I can see the darkness in your eyes, child.
I met a boy.
Boy.
The chief answer.
No.
He said he could help me.
It's a trick.
He said it could be normal.
Normal?
Yes.
No boy is going to save you. No one can. When they see the rot growing inside you,
no.
They will turn their back on you. The gods can only fix you through my hand. You're going nowhere.
No.
You will not defy the gods. Come, child, take my hand. Come, Senua.
No! I am leaving!
You cannot escape the darkness. Your curse will make everyone suffer. You will have blood on your hands!
It's done. You did it, but there's more. Go. There's more. You're tired, but you have to keep going. There's still more. It's not going to be easy. You're getting tired. Can you do another one? It's too much. Have you got the energy? She hasn't got the energy.
No.
Too much to do.
I want to tell you a story about a god of the Northmen called Baldur. The second son of Odin, he was beautiful, good, and wise. He was fair of feature, he spoke fair words, he gave fair judgments. Light shone from him. Only good things were told of him. Yet he was the first of the gods to die.
But the bridge is broken. There's no way you can fix it. What do you do now, sir?
The Northmen tell this story about the death of Baldur. It begins with dark dreams. Night after night, Baldur dreams of his own death, and the gods fear for his life. So Baldur's mother makes everything in the world, fire, water, iron, stone, earth, wood, beasts, birds, serpents, poison, sickness, swear an oath not to harm her son. One by one, they each make their vow. Neither weapons nor wood will injure him, Baldur's mother boasts. Only Loki, father of Hela, the mistress of death, is not amused.
He's waiting for you. Always said he's close. He loves you. Calling you. Dillion. Dillion, we're here. Dillion. We're nearly here. We're
thank you. Dillion.
There he is.
There he is.
What are you waiting for?
Quick, find a way.
Find him.
Go through him
before he disappears.
Dillion, don't lose him.
He's been away too many times.
You always let him disappear.
Dillion, there he is.
Quick.
Where is he?
Where's he gone?
We're in the wrong world.
He's not here.
She's in the wrong world.
He's not in this world.
He's in the other one.
He's in the other one.
He's in the dark world.
The dark.
The dark world.
The world once seemed so simple. Black and white. Darkness and light. Narrow dividing lines of our own making. Dillion taught her to see further. To peek through the cracks and see the worlds of color stretching away from the gloom. And Senua explored new paths into the unknown.
Feast and rejoice, and amuse themselves by throwing spears and stones at Balder, striking at him with sword and axe. But he comes to no harm, whatever they do. The gods never cease to wonder at this great marvel. But Loki shapes himself into a woman, and asks Baldur's mother, is it really true that all things promise to keep him safe? I did not ask the mistletoe, Baldur's mother confesses. I thought it was too young. Oh dear.
Do you remember meeting him beneath the tree?
He saw that she was strong. He cared in a way that nobody else did. He was the only one that really loved her.
He did love her.
He's the reason she keeps fighting.
Dillion saved her.
You owe your life to Dillion.
You owe everything to him. Senua saved you from that.
You've got it.
Why isn't he here?
He's gone.
He's in the dark world.
He's gone to the dark world.
You're in the wrong world.
He's in the other world.
The dark world.
Without you.
Dillion's in the tower.
The Northmen tell this story about the death of Baldur. It begins with dark dreams. Night after night, Baldur dreams of his own death, and the gods fear for his life. So Baldur's mother makes everything in the world, fire, water, iron, stone, earth, wood, beasts, birds, serpents, poison, sickness, swear an oath not to harm her son. One by one, they each make their vow. Neither weapons nor wood will injure him, Baldur's mother boasts. Only Loki, father of Hela, the mistress of death, is not amused.
He cared in a way that nobody else did.
Nobody will love her.
There he is.
Where are you taking
him? He's up there. How
do you get out of this? There's a way. There is a way up there. Find the way.
Loki makes a dart out of mistletoe and goes to the gods as they throw things at Baldur. The blind god, Huth, was there. Loki asks him why he wasn't taking part. Huth says, I cannot see where Baldur stands, and even if I could see him, I have no weapon. Loki replies, here is a wand. I will tell you where he stands. And Hurth throws the mistletoe at Baldur. It pierces through him, and to everyone's horror, Baldur is killed. And for this, Hurth is slain. The Northmen tell how the gods mourned Baldur. His body was to be burnt on his ship, but they could not manage to push it into the sea and sent for a giantess to do it. She comes riding a wolf and has vipers for her reins. She pushes Baldur's ship into the sea with such force that
years had passed since she left her father. She trained hard alongside her friend, Dillion. She saw things no one else could. Patterns, shapes, movement. An intuition that made her an exceptional warrior. Friendship turned to love. But the shadow of darkness never let her go, and she was caught between two worlds. That of Zinbel and her past.
Your curse has claimed Dillion.
Her future.
Poor Dillion. He didn't know.
Two realities tearing at her soul.
You remember meeting him beneath the tree?
What if they're all about wasting your time, just delaying minute by minute by minute? What does she think she's doing? You're special. She thinks she...
They mean nothing.
Gods are just
playing.
What if the gods are laughing at her?
Messing with her.
It wouldn't
be the first time.
Overcome with grief, the gods send Hermod to ride to Hel and ask Hela to let Baldur return home. All the gods are weeping, he says. Are they? Asks Hela. We shall see if he is truly missed. If everything in the world will weep for him, he shall go back to the gods. But if even one thing refuses, Baldur stays with me. The gods send messengers everywhere. Weep for Baldur. Weep him out of hell. And everything wept. Men, beasts, earth, stone, trees, metal, everything. Except for a giantess they find in a cave. Baldur was never my friend, she says. Let Hel keep what she has. The Northmen say that the giantess must have been Loki in disguise.
Dillion saved you from them. He's the reason she's alive at all. You have no chance. Nobody will love you again. Ever again. Is the reason she's alive at all. Remember, Dillion. What do you remember? Do you remember the sound of his voice? Thank you.
she was cursed.
He saved you when everyone else turned their backs.
He was the only one that really loved her.
He did love her. Do you think she remembers him?
Whispering in your ear. Dillion saved her.
You owe your life to Dillion.
You owe everything to him.
Was the only one that didn't mind the curse.
He loved her so much.
Do you know? Wasn't worth it. You lost the lives.
Still alive and dead. you astray.
You should have listened to your father when you had the chance.
Why didn't you listen to him?
This love has taught you how
to have no time for this. Speed up.
They've set you trials to distract you.
They've set you up, and now they're going to watch you fall.
What if these trials mean nothing?
Laughing at you.
What if they take you no closer to Dillion?
Curse.
Now the darkness is swallowing
this. Get in the way.
What if they are just to tire you out, to make you weak before the battle?
The Northmen tell how the gods punished Loki for Baldur's death. They captured him and took him to a cave. They fetched his two sons and turned one into a wolf, and he ripped his brother apart. The gods used Loki's own son's entrails to tie him down and turned these bonds to iron and dangled a poisonous serpent over his face so that its venom would drip onto him. Each time the venom drips onto Loki's face, he writhes in agony. The Northmen say that is the cause of earthquakes. A reminder, perhaps, that if even gods must accept death,
he was the
soul to be.
Remember, Dillion. Do you remember?
Do you remember the sound of Hela's heart?
He led you astray.
You should have listened to your father when you had the chance.
Why didn't you listen to him?
This love has tortured you, and it tortures me. Nobody will love her.
Can you remember what love feels like?
Look what happens to the things she loves.
She destroys.
Dillion never much cared for the underworld, and looked dimly upon the druids, like her father, Zinbel. I guess he took after his father. A chieftain who believed nothing he couldn't see. And he happened to be blind. She felt safe in Dillion's arms. Glad to see the world through his eyes. Slowly. Darkness that had bound her so tightly. Dillion never much cared for the underworld, and looked dimly upon the druids, like her father, Zinbel. I guess he took after his father, a chieftain who believed nothing he couldn't see, and he happened to be blind. She felt safe in Dillion's arms, learned to see the world through his eyes. And slowly, the darkness that had bound her so tightly began to unravel.
You're going to fall, careful.
No, she's not. She's not going to fall. She's strong. She's steady. She can do it. You can do it, Senua. Do it, Senua.
Senua, your father cannot understand your darkness. He cannot see through your eyes. No one can. My own father was born blind. Doesn't have the faintest idea of what the night looks like. The word dark to him means as little as the word light. So someone is afraid of the dark. Should we fix them by taking away their sight? Would you give up the beautiful world that you, and only you, can see just to be rid of your nightmares? Or is this the price you pay for the gift you have? The gift that makes you so special in my eyes. Just another part of the person I know.
I left for the wilds to protect you from my darkness. Because I love you. But it made it worse. I'm so sorry.
What if this is pointless? What if you're wrong?
What if this has nothing to do with the sword?
What if we're wrong?
The sword will never be yours.
What if this is the end?
It's just a trick. It's just a pointless test.
You've been fooled before. You could be fooled again.
You're being tested.
You don't know. It's just their game. You never know which way...
Sigmund's sister trades shapes with a sorceress. And in disguise, she lies with her own brother. She gives birth to a son named Sinfjotli. After a time, she sends him to the forest to Sigmund. He tests the boy and finds him strong and fearless, and so they go to take their vengeance on King Siggeir. But luck is not on their side. They're captured, and Siggeir has them buried.
I saw once a plague strike northern lands of ice. It was so terrible that not the oldest man among us could remember the like. Hundreds died.
The sickness took nearly every person younger than 40 and many older. And where dying mothers gave birth, the marks of the plague were on the babes as they came out of the womb.
Where are we?
I don't like it.
This place feels...
What is this place?
It feels wrong.
It feels strange. Where is it? Where are we?
Turn back.
This is wrong. This has to be wrong.
This place stinks. There he is. Dillion. The light.
Go towards it.
He's in the house. He's going in.
He's disappearing.
Follow him.
Don't let him disappear.
The air.
Where's it gone? Keep going.
How do you find it? It's just a trial.
It's just another test.
You just have to solve it, and then you will find him.
Then you will succeed. Just one.
It's a test. Like the old warrior trials. Dillion will help me.
The stench of rot. She can almost taste it. Do you smell it? Don't worry. Not everyone can. It was a warm spring day when she went to the river with Dillion and the others. But the water... She could taste the rot. No one else could. She knew something was wrong. Something sinister. She begged them to leave, but they just laughed at her. But soon enough... As the bodies piled up, no one was laughing. And they knew that she was not like them.
You have to get in. Find a way.
Dillion will disappear soon. Find a way.
It's all up to you.
It's another test.
Don't fail.
The light is still glowing, but soon it will go out.
You haven't failed yet. You mustn't fail now.
found a way.
To climb the tower.
The ladder.
Quick. What now?
You can see it. Aligned to the truth. The bridge.
The Northmen speak of a death moon, a light shaped like a half moon that appears inside a house and goes around the walls. I once saw the death moon appear at a farm, and first the shepherd died, then a guest died, and then the farmhands, and then the farmer and six of his men drowned at sea. But that is not the end of it, because the dead return to haunt the living. If you see the death moon, then beware, because there will be death in that house.
You did it. She did it.
It's not done yet.
Just a small piece of the puzzle.
Come to me. Where are you?
I'm here. I'm right here.
Are you in there? Come out if you are.
The runes.
Focus.
Focus on the runes.
There was a Northman called Grettir. Big, red-haired, immensely strong. But he was afraid of the dark. It happened one night that an undead creature came to his house to drag him outside into darkness and kill him. He resisted with every ounce of his strength. He clung to the doorframe, but it gave way, and they spilled out of the house, and the monster fell back. And the moon shone down on its ghastly face. Grettir, terrified, cuts off its head, but is cursed.
What's that sound? Dillion! They're coming for me!
It's close. Move away. Senua, move away. You'll die. Run. Run now. It's not safe here. Run.
Senua.
The door. Your sword. You came through the wrong door. Where's your sword?
Senua! What happened?
They're blaming me for the plague. They say that I'm cursed. What if they're right?
How would they know such a thing? Are they gods? None of us are. They're just people. Good people, but they're scared. They're afraid of what they can't see. Like children scared of the dark. They make up stories to fill the void. That doesn't make them true.
What if my father was right?
You have to step out of this darkness. Let them see who you really are, like I have. You're not a monster.
Without you, this darkness has made me a monster.
Killing you would be too easy.
They're taking your memories to torture you.
They're taking you from the inside.
You're disappearing one memory at a time. Every time you
memories were yours, but they're the gods now.
Nothing is yours.
As Sigmund and Sinfjotli are being buried alive, Sigmund's sister throws an armful of straw into the grave mound. Hidden in the straw is Sigmund's sword, the gift of Odin.
They cut their way out of the grave.
Strike vengeance from your heart, Senua, as there is always a heavy price to pay.